Hi, welcome to 90% Knitting. This is episode 226, and I'm Lisa, your host, also known as Fibernymph, on Ravelry and Instagram. Today is New Year's Eve day. It's the 31st of December, Saturday, and by the time this is up, you will probably be in the new year, I imagine, because this may not go up until a little later today. I don't know. And I apologize if you can hear any background noise happening. My husband took this week off work between Christmas and New Year's with the primary goal of doing some drywall work that has been needed to be done in my basement. And he's been quite diligent about it. And today is a sanding day. And so he is running the sander off and on all day. I've been trying to squeeze this recording in between his bursts of sanding. I've lost track of how many times I've started. So I'm just going to push through and hope that you cannot hear the sanding and the sweeper that he's running to try to keep the dust at a minimum. There is no way to keep the dust to a minimum. I've had to cover everything and keep doors closed up here because that dust just filters right upstairs. It's been so much fun. Anyway, sorry. I'm also a little under the weather. I went to the doctor this past week for my annual checkup, and while I was there, she's like, oh yeah, you have an ear infection. I'm thinking, great. So I apparently have an ear and sinus infection that I didn't know I had. I thought it was just allergies. I knew I didn't feel totally great, but yeah, that's what it is. So I'm on an antibiotic, which has its own set of, you know, side effects sometimes. And I'm not totally feeling 100%, but I feel pretty good right now and I've got energy right now. So I thought I would try to get this podcast out before the end of the year. Anyway, I did not have a chance to look and see if anybody new introduced themselves on the 90% Knitting group, but I will try to remember to do that next time. In the meantime, if you're new here, thank you so much for coming and checking out the podcast. And welcome to everybody, whether you've been a longtime viewer or not. I'm glad to have you here. And just to remind you, we do have a 90% Knitting group on Ravelry with a welcome thread. You're welcome to introduce yourself. There's a Fibernymph Dyeworks group on Ravelry as well. And there's a Fibernymph Dyeworks page on Facebook, which if you like that, you'll get news about both the podcast and any shop news that I have for you. So that's a really good place, a resource to find out information. And lastly, I am on Instagram, as I always mention. I'm there as Fibernymph, and it's, I would say, maybe 20% shop businessy stuff, maybe not even that much, maybe like 15%. And the rest of it's just sort of my knitting and, you know, food and cooking and life stuff all rolled into one. I've thought about starting my own like Fibernymph Instagram, but that seems redundant because I don't post a lot of business stuff on my personal Instagram, like not enough to be obnoxious, at least I don't think so. So I'm just going to keep the one, because I don't have time to keep up with two, quite honestly. Anyway, so we're kind of winding down the holiday season here. Like I said, today's New Year's Eve. Tomorrow will be New Year's Day. Since it's a Sunday, everybody has work off on Monday still. So the real world doesn't start again until Tuesday. Aside from the fact that my daughter goes home, she's been home now for over a week, which has been lovely, and I love having her here. But aside from the fact that that means she'll be going back home, I'm really looking forward to getting back into a normal routine. I always love the holidays, but I'm always ready for the new year to start back into the normal routine, and just that's comforting for me. So we've got that coming up in a few days, but until then, I'm just going to enjoy things the way they are. But we did have a really nice Christmas, so if you celebrated Christmas last week, or Hanukkah, or whatever holiday you celebrate, I hope it was wonderful for you too. And in answer to so many people's questions, yes, Bill loved his mittens. they were a hit, so, and I knew he would like them. I still don't know how much he'll actually wear them, but he definitely liked them a lot and appreciated the time I put into making them. So it was all good. let's get into the program. I don't have a whole lot of knitting, but I do have a lot of other stuff to talk about today. Just sort of year-endy kind of stuff. that I started talking about last week, but we'll be continuing this week. So let's get into that. I honestly, like I said, not a whole lot of knitting to show you. But two projects. I have worked on two projects since the last time I talked to you, which has now been like, what, 10 days? And the one isn't even knitting. It is crochet. And so you know what that is. It is my Granny Stripes blanket, which I am just so in love with this project. I'm still loving it. This is how far I am now. Obviously, it's not getting any wider. It's going to remain the same width. But it is up to about, I would say, 8 inches. I measured it earlier today, but then I worked on it a little more. But it's still probably right around 8 inches. So it's just eating up minis like crazy. I realized earlier today that I never started a project page for it on Ravelry. I've rectified that. So there is a project page, and I have explained what I've done so far. So if you're interested, I also included a link for how I'm doing my magic knots. It's a YouTube video, the way, because there's more than one way to do magic knots, apparently. So I included the link for how I'm doing them. I did not include a link for how to do granny stripes because I used multiple videos for learning how to do that. I just kind of put it all together based on a few different videos. So if you go on YouTube and you do a search for granny stripes, you'll come up with a bunch of videos. I would just say watch a handful of them. You'll get the general idea and it'll be all good. But anyway, still enjoying this. I did finally put it into my Bags by Awesome Granny bag, the patchwork snowman. So it's in here, and like I said, just going through minis like crazy. I'm probably gonna end up having to start scavenging minis before this blanket's done, which I think I mentioned last week. So stay tuned for that. Oh my gosh, I feel like I'm gonna sneeze, and I don't want to. This dust is killing me on top of the sinus infection already. Anyway, just to assure you, all of my yarn is covered. My personal yarn, some of it's not, but like shop yarn, everything is in bins and bags and covered, and there's no dust getting into my shop yarn. Everything at this point is covered. It's just, it looks, never mind. Anyway, it's horrible. Yeah, so anyway. Granny Stripes blanket, still loving it. It's still very relaxing. I'm using a D hook. I've watched some other podcasts recently where people are doing it with fingering weight yarn, but they're using larger hooks. The D is working out really well for me. I like the drape that I'm getting with it, so I'm good with that. I think that's a 3.25 millimeter, if I remember correctly. I don't really know my crochet hook measurements, and it's not on my little cheat sheet over there. That's just knitting needles, so I can't even look, but I'm pretty sure that's what it is. I think it's 3.25. It's working for me. Your mileage may vary. Okay, so the only other project that I've worked on this week was my Christmas Eve cast on, and that was my sock blank, which is my literally, I dyed this the Welcome to Whoville sock blank. In the it's a happenstance with sparkle sock blank, so it's got the Stellina in it. And here it is. I've obviously put a lot of time into this. I'm loving this project so much, and I want to use as much of the sock blank as I can. So I decided instead of using the contrasting yarn, I was going to use some magenta for the heels and toes. I'm just going to use the sock blank yarn. Because I like how it's transitioning. The first part was mostly all speckles, obviously, and I was getting antsy because I really wanted to move into the colors. And I kind of thought about cutting it off at one point. I'm like, nope, I'm just going to let it go and do its thing. And I'm glad I did because I really like how that worked out. So we've got, this whole speckle section here. Please don't pay attention to my crappy nails. They need to be redone. Anyway, and then it transitions into the icy blue, and now we're in the pink, and so that's where I ended, and that was perfect. Usually when I'm doing an afterthought heel, I wait until both socks are done, and then I do the afterthought heels at the same time. Well, not at the same time, but one after another. They're the last thing I do. But because I wanted the heel on this sock to be pink, I just did it right away. So that's what I'm working on. I'm almost done with the sock. I've probably got, or the heel, another inch or so to go on the heel. And then I will be finished with that. But otherwise, it's just a plain vanilla sock. I did do a twisted rib for about, I would say, about an inch and a half. So it's longer than my usual ribbed cuff. Is that going to focus? I don't know. But I almost never do a twisted rib. There we go. But for whatever reason, it seemed like a good idea. So I did it, and it was fine. It's funny, it doesn't look as clean as most twisted ribs do just because of the nubbiness of the sock blank yarn. But I really like it. I like how it's turning out, and I can't wait to start the second one. So the second sock, I'll still be kind of in the pink, and then it's going to go into speckles. But this speckled section is a little more intense than the first one was, so I'm really interested to see how different it's going to turn out. I think that's the fun of sock blanks, is just not knowing what you're going to end up with. So anyway, that's it. Those are my two projects, and I'm using my not Suburban Stitcher, Steel City Stitcher Grinch bag, because how could I not use my Grinch bag for the Welcome to Whoville socks? So anyway, that is it for my crafting this week. Nothing else has occurred. I wanted to sit and spin one day, or actually, I've wanted to sit and spin a few different days. It's just not happened. And right now, I am not getting spinning out to do with all this dust in the air up here. So, anyway, but you know what? I'm fine with just having two projects on the go right now. I've got other things, obviously, that you haven't seen in a while. I'll get back to them. But just not right now. And it's not looking like the antler cardigan's going to get done by the end of this year. I really thought I might get that finished, but I don't believe so. And I'm okay with that. Maybe it will be my first finished object of 2017. That would be fine with me too. But anyway, I did actually go in my effort to do some tidying up before the end of the year. My online tidying up. I went into Ravelry today, and I hibernated a couple of things, just things I know I'm not going to work on anytime soon. I do that occasionally because I don't like having a lot of active projects, but it's fine. I had something here too that I was going to tell you about, but no, there it is, and that's actually later in the podcast, so never mind. I just wanted to find my note. So yeah, I hibernated a couple of things. The things that are left as active projects are things that I do plan to actively work on, aside from the couple of blanket projects, and I have that diagonal shawl, that bias wrap that I'm working on. I'm leaving them active because I know I'll pull them out occasionally, like the granny squares blanket and my hand spun log cabin blanket and that wrap, you know, I'll pull them out eventually and work on them a little while, but none of them are ones that I feel this need to work on a lot at one time. And so that's why I'm leaving them active because I know they'll see some work, but yeah, they don't need to be hibernated. There's other things that I just like that interlude shawl that I started a while ago because I thought I might give it to my mom for Christmas. Then I remembered, oh, I have a shawl to give her for Christmas already. So that one, I don't know what to do with. I like it and I like the yarn I'm using for it, but I don't have like anything driving me to really finish it right now. So I hibernated that for the time being. I can't remember. I think there was something else I may have hibernated, but anyway, things will get done. But I'm happy with these two projects right now, and so that's all I'm worried about. Okay, so let's talk about the Work Your Whips Cal. Today is obviously the last day to finish any whips that you have been working on and get your finished object pictures posted. I will announce the final winners next week on the podcast. That would be December winners, that would be the November Cast-On-Itis winner, and whatever winners I decide to do from the whole shebang, from all 3 months together. Excuse me. I have the hiccups all of a sudden. Anyway, so I will announce winners next week. I'm so appreciative of how enthusiastic you guys have been about the Work Your Whips Cal. It's been a lot of fun. I did not get a whole lot of whips finished, but you guys went like gangbusters and you did get a lot finished. And I love the community and the chatter that we've had going on in that group. I really hope that that will carry over into the new knit along that's going to be happening next year. And speaking of which, let's talk about that next. First of all, I did finally get the threads up about that earlier today. I'm sorry it took me so long, but again, between the chaos going on here and me not quite feeling good, it just hadn't been happening. But I have two threads up for the new knit along. So the new knit along is a year in the life of a knitter. And so there's the general informational thread, which is up with all of the what you need to know if you want to participate, and it's very open and loose. There's not a lot of strict guidelines. The only absolute criteria or required element for participating and posting is that you be working on something that somehow relates to that quarter's theme. The themes are so open to interpretation, though, I don't think that should be any problem for anyone. So again, just to remind you, the winter quarter will be January, February, and March. The themes for that first quarter are warmth, coziness, and home. So anything that you can relate to those themes, however you want to do it, that's fine. And our January focus is going to be bulky weight yarn. It's not required that you use bulky weight yarn. The monthly focuses are more like challenges, or if you want to do something extra and challenge yourself to use that yarn. And that's especially helpful if it's not something that you tend to use, or something later on in the year when we get into techniques and things, if it's something that you don't tend to do. It's just an extra way to push yourself, I guess, would be it. But my main goal for this knit along for next year is that it just be something that we can enjoy together, relaxing. And I really want to focus on the community aspect of it. So that's why I also have the first quarter thread up. That's going to be where you're going to chatter. Please post what you're working on, post anything related to the themes, even if it doesn't have to do with what you're working on. If it's something else in life that's relevant, please talk and share about it if you want to. Books that maybe you're reading that you feel like relate to it. Anything like that. There will be prizes. I'm going to do monthly drawings and I'll do a quarterly drawing. They're not based on finished objects, they're just based on participation in that quarterly thread. And obviously, for the monthly drawing, I'll just pull from the posts that were posted in the applicable month. But this is not meant to be a prize-driven along. It's meant to be. And I am calling it a knit along, even though it's open to other crafts. You can read all of that in the thread, but knitting, crochet, spinning, weaving, and sewing, those are the five crafts that this encompasses. Some of the focuses, the monthly focuses, are very much yarn and knitting specific, though, so they won't really apply to you if you're doing something that won't work with. But again, it's not necessary. The monthly challenges are not necessary. It's just you need to be doing something related to the quarterly theme. That's the biggest thing. So one of those themes, because obviously there's three themes. You don't have to do all three in one project. So anyway, I'm very excited for this new knit along, and I hope that you are too. In my notes, I have new knit along for 2016. It's not, it's 2017. But I do believe I wrote it right in the Ravelry group, so you can check that out. If you have any questions about the how-to stuff of the knit along, please post those questions in that first general thread and I will answer them there. That way, we'll keep all the questions and answers in one place. But as far as whatever you're working on and your chatter and finished objects, whip pictures, everything else, that goes in the quarterly thread. Okay? Hopefully, that will be simple. It should be simple. I'm trying to keep it simple, but I feel like I just said a whole lot of stuff that sounded confusing. Anyway, we'll go with it. All right. Ask questions if you need to. That's it for most of the 90% stuff. The other stuff is sort of related to what I started talking about last week when I recorded, was like my year in retrospect stuff, and I told you what all I had knit last year. And that's always fun. I love going back and seeing what I was able to accomplish knitting wise in my year. I still have not actually looked at my spinning. I meant to do that here. I'm going to bring that up right now. Ooh, live. Let's see. I use the ink pad app on my phone. I know you can't see a thing there. It's probably too bright. Anyway, it's ink pad, and I use that to keep track of my spinning totals for the year. So this year, it started out with the Shetland. Do you remember the natural colors of Shetland? We did the natural spin along. So I spun 83 yards of ecru, 250 yards of fawn, 233 yards of moret, and 267 yards of gray. And I never spun the black. It's still sitting over here on my shelf, waiting for me to spin it. I spun a sanguine griffin bat. That tells you how old it is because she hasn't been the sanguine griffin in a while. It was called Sir Bat, and it was a 50-33-17 merino, superwash merino silk bat, 3 ounces. I got 205 yards of a 2-ply sport weight. I did a loop bullseye bump, stormy sea, and got 261 yards. I did that during Stash Dash. And then I did the loop bullseye bump that I just most recently showed you. That was Dune, a 4.6 ounce bat, 215 yards, Navajo plied. And that's all the spinning I did this year that I completed. I did start that blue Briar Rose Fibers BFL. See, remember my goal for this year? My spinning goal was to spin a lot of my oldest fiber stash, and I think I had picked out six different things. The sanguine griffin was one of them, but that was it. The blue, I got stuck on that blue BFL because there was so much of it and it just wasn't holding my attention. Now the loop bullseye bumps were nice to get out of my stash because I've had so many loop bullseye bumps and they were just sitting here. So I'm glad I did get those spun. And I think I'm going to continue spinning those only because the BFL is up on my traveler up at the mountain house, and so I don't have a lot of opportunities to spin on that unless I'm up there. And usually, if I have time, I'm knitting. But my sidekick is what's here, and since I keep the jumbo flyer on that usually, I mean, I could change it out and put a regular one on it, but I like using the jumbo flyer on that spinning wheel since I have it. And they are perfect for those jumbo bobbins are perfect for loop bullseye bumps because they hold so much. So yeah, I'm not making any spinning goals next year, I don't think. I don't know. I haven't thought about goals. I'm going to talk about goals for next year next time I record. Anyway, so that was spinning, such as it is. It wasn't a giant spinning year. But anyway, I did talk about my knitting projects last week. I went back after that though, and I looked at what yarn I used because I was kind of curious, and I had roughly 61 projects. I don't think that's accurate for what I told you last time because there was actually some of my project pages have like multiple things, like the dishcloths and things like that. But out of the 61 project pages that I looked at, which include either finished projects from this year or things that I'm currently working on. So that's a little different too, because last week I just talked about finished objects. But out of the 61 projects that I'm either currently working on or have finished this year, 33 of them I did out of stash yarn or hand spun. And for stash, I'm defining stash yarn as yarn that I did not purchase this year. So yarn that was already in my stash before the beginning of 2016, or hand spun yarn. And I think most of the things that I did out of hand spun this year was hand spun that I spun prior to this year. I can't be 100% sure on that right at the moment, but stash or hand spun. So that's like over half of the projects I did were out of stash or hand spun. And some of those were out of some pretty deep stash too, which is awesome. I love using Deep Stash. 17 of my projects were out of my own yarn, Fiber Nymph Dyeworks yarn. So I never feel too bad about that just because I like knitting with my own yarn and it gives me a chance to show people what it does. And about 10 of those projects were out of new stash yarn. So it was either yarn that I purchased this year or yarn that I purchased this year specifically to do certain projects. So, you know, that's okay too. You know, that's like a sixth of the projects were that. I feel like that's a pretty good breakdown. I'm really happy about having used as much stash yarn. I should never say never, but I will probably never be one of those people who says, I'm only going to knit with stash yarn for the entire year. Because I love knitting with my own yarn and I love buying yarn from other indie dyers, you know. And then I have my favorite commercial yarns too, you know, like Cascade 220 and Noro and things like that. So I can't say that I'll ever do that probably, but I like to work on my stash as much as I can. Okay, so there was that. But anyway, then I further looked at my projects and I wanted to talk about some favorites, just because, you know, I love watching when other podcasters do their like monthly favorite videos or something. Again, I will probably never be one of them doing that only because I don't have time to do an extra podcast a lot of the time, but I do enjoy watching those. So I thought I would just add that element to this podcast since I'm talking about my 2016 knitting and projects. So let me talk about some favorites. In general, anything that I made out of my own yarns, like Fiber Nymph Dyeworks yarn, or out of my hand spun, those are always favorites just because the yarn is special to me in one way or another. So that's a general kind of thing. As far as one of my most favorite projects that I did was actually a most recent project, and that was the Woolastook mittens that I did for Bill for Christmas. Obviously, they were happy. It was a happy project for me based on the recipient, you know, knitting something for my husband. I always enjoy doing that because he is very knitworthy. But I also enjoyed them because it was sort of a challenge for me, the color work. I'm not super great at color work. I don't feel like I am. So the fact that I was able to do those fairly respectably was nice. And I used my own yarn and I loved the colors that I chose for those. So in general, those were a wonderful project and definitely one of my most favorite things that I finished this year. Another favorite project would be my vacation shawl. Obviously, that was the shawl that I started on the flight to Antigua earlier this year. So there are definitely memories attached to that shawl because I got engaged in Antigua. So there's that. The other aspect is that I used Deep Stash for that. It was plant-based fiber. It was hemp and linen yarns that I used. And those are not fibers that I knit with very often ever. So the fact that I did something outside of my normal comfort zone for the yarn, that made it a special project and I really love it. I love how it drapes. It was not a pattern. It was just one of my triangular shawls my elongated triangular shawls that I like to knit on my own, like just winging it kind of thing. So my vacation shawl is definitely one of my favorite projects this year for all of those reasons. Another one that is a favorite, my lefty shawlette, that I really liked because it's different than what I would usually knit. I rarely ever knit anything in all white, and obviously that wasn't all white. It had the bright colored leaves and stripes in it, but it was a very different color palette for me to use with all of that white in it. And I really liked how it turned out. I wasn't sure if I would like it as I would like when I started knitting it, but when it was finished, I just adored it. And I know I'll get a lot of use out of that in coming years. Let's see, what else? Socks. Okay, so You know, I love to knit socks. It's one of the things I knit the most. And pretty much anytime I knit out of like my own self-striping yarn, those are always favorites. And I did knit my husband a couple pairs of those this year. And I knit myself some too. But I tell you what, the West Yorkshire bird yarn socks that I made him a pair and I made myself a pair. The one was pheasant, that was the one he got. And the one I got made for myself was bullfinch. I really love those. Loved how they turned out. I loved using the contrasting yarn for the heels. And I would say that would have to be a technique this year that I used more than I've ever used before. Yarn for contrasting heels or heels and toes. And I really enjoyed that as a technique this year. So those would be my happy socks for the year. I mean, I love knitting socks in general. There were also the socks that I made that my mom ended up stealing out of the Neely's Knits You're a Firework yarn. That was a happy yarn, kind of just because I liked the socks, but the fact that she wanted them and they were a comforting thing for her at a hard time. And that was also a pattern that I winged, and I really liked that staggered rib that I did on those. And so then I knit myself another pair of staggered ribbed socks, which I may end up having to write that pattern up. But I did those out of that first fall yarn that I had from Highland Handmades. And here's the funny thing. I had knit my husband a pair of socks out of some Arnie and Carlos yarn. Did I tell you? I may have told you this last week. I don't remember. But they were too short for him. I mean, he said they were okay at first, but then after a while, we realized they were too short for him. And so, like the cuff part, he likes a longer cuff. So I ended up giving him the first fall socks because he also likes a ribbed sock. So yeah, he has my first fall socks. So I have to knit another pair of those sometime. Anyway, so that's socks. Let's see, challenges. My favorite projects that were challenging this year. I would say, well, I already said about the Woolastook mittens. Those were definitely a challenge for me. But overall, the biggest challenge I would say was my wedding skirt. And that was a very fulfilling challenge to do, obviously, because it was what I wore for my wedding. But it was also knitting out of hempathy, which, yarn I don't tend to knit with very often, and just putting all those patterns together that I did and making it work, and the stuff that I sewed to go along with it, that's part of it. That was definitely a challenge that I'm very proud of. Trying something new, and especially whenever it's something big like that, like I needed to wear it for my wedding, so it had to work. So that was cool. I would say, let's see, let's go to in progress. I can't leave those out because I do have some projects in progress that were my favorites. And I would say my antler cardigan is definitely a favorite because I know once I finally get it finished, I'm gonna love it. It promises to fit really well, and I love everything about it, especially now that I've shortened it. I just need to get it done. So I think that will be a favorite just because I've done so few actual large garments this year. But the other one, hands down, is definitely this Granny Stripes blanket. I'm just enjoying it so much that it is definitely a favorite project for this year. And then I thought I would add in a last favorite category category for knitting, and that is past projects that I have been enjoying wearing. So things that I've knit in past years, and that will always be socks and hats. I always wear my socks, always wear my hats, and I love wearing them. But there's two specific projects that I've made in the past that I just adore and I use all the time. And the one is this scrappy shawl. This was leftover yarn scraps from that big, huge Afghan that I did a couple of years ago that was gigantic. But I had all this yarn left over. And so this was the first of my elongated triangular shawls that I ever did, just on my own, no pattern. And I use this so much. I love wrapping up in it. It's so soft and so squishy. It's definitely been a favorite. I get a lot of use out of it. But the other one that's been kind of a surprise to me is my Nermalintu scarfy thing here. This elongated or asymmetrical, I guess. and poorly knit, because you can see that little bump right there by my nose. That was not supposed to be there. That was me screwing the pattern up. But I knit this out of a loop bullseye bump that I had spun. There are so many errors in this. I screwed up the lace work in the one section, this brown section, it's goofed up. Is it? Yeah, there's no lace sections earlier. So the lace is messed up. My spinning was definitely imperfect. I've got those little pigtail things boinking out different places. And I thought, you know what? I'm not sure I'll ever really get much use out of this whenever I first knit it. I have worn this so often. I love it. It's, you know, the greens and browns and neutral. It's just a lovely, soft, neutral scarf that it wraps really nicely. It looks nice with or without a shawl pin. It's really warm. I'm wearing this to death so far this winter. It's crazy. So this was a surprise finished object that I did last year that I never expected to get as much use out of or enjoy as much as I've been enjoying it. So what can you do? That happens occasionally. That's a happy thing, right? Okay. That's all the knitting favorites that I have. I was going to share a couple of new... Oh, the sander just went on. Yikes. Hopefully you can't hear that. Anyway, podcasts. I wanted to talk about some favorite podcasts that I've come up with for this year. You know, I, like you guys, I listen to and watch a lot of podcasts. I don't get to watch all of them every single time they record, but there are some that I pretty much never miss because they are very much favorites for me. And I don't mean that to take away from any of the other podcasts out there, because if you look at the podcasts on my YouTube lineup that I watch, there's lots of them and I enjoy them all. But this year there were three. I'm looking at my list. Three that really stood out that I started watching or listening to this year and have just enjoyed so, so much. The first one is an audio podcast, and it's Yarns at Yinhu with Sarah, who's Sarah Pomegranate. Now, I'm saying that this is a new-to-me podcast for this year. I believe I've listened to it in the past, but this year was one that I started listening to it, like, religiously. Every time she records, I make sure I listen, and I look forward to it. What I love about Sarah's podcast is her content is lovely. You know, there's some knitting, there's some sewing, there's, you know, her other post-apocalyptic life skills, you know, cooking. And it's just, it's a very relaxing and calming podcast for me, both content-wise and Sarah herself. She's just a very, she's got a wonderful voice to listen to that has that effect on me. So I've really enjoyed her podcast. Again, that's an audio podcast, Yarns at Yinhu. A video podcast that I like very much for the same reasons is the Gentle Knitter podcast with Nicole, which is a new podcast this year. She just started it. She is another one who has just that very calming nature about her. And that's more of what I would really like to have in my own life and in my own self. I'm not a real calming kind of person, though. I'm kind of like, woo! I'm all over the place all the time, but I'm striving to bring more calm and relaxing nature to myself. So I figure if I listen and watch those kind of podcasts, maybe that'll help. But Nicole is also just very calming to listen to. Like it says, the Gentle Knitter. She is just a very quiet, calming presence. And I enjoy her projects that she does and hearing about her work that she does at the museum she works at and her dog and it's just a very nice podcast. So those are two that are very relaxing. A third one, I won't say I enjoy it for its relaxation aspects of it, but I do enjoy its content and the host is delightful. And that is Brooklyn Knit Folk with Jacqueline. That's a video podcast as well. And she is from Brooklyn, and I love how she includes snippets of life from the city in there. And her, she did Vlogmas, as did so many other podcasters, but I really enjoyed her Vlogmas videos this year. They were lovely and just a lot of fun. She's quite young. I mean, okay, I'm 50, so anybody under 30 is young, trust me. But She's just, I love watching her, and I kind of see in her my daughter probably in another 5 years or so, maybe, as she's launching into her life and living her own life somewhere apart from me and everything. I don't know. That's maybe a weird thing to say, but it is one of the reasons that I enjoy watching Jacqueline because I'm fairly certain I could be Jacqueline's mother. I mean, age-wise anyway. But I do enjoy her podcast and I love her projects. Like her knitting projects are fun. She's gotten into socks this year, so I love that. But her sewing too, and she's not afraid to tackle projects, and she talks about that a lot, like not having any fear, just doing things, not worrying about being afraid of doing them, just try and enjoy them and everything. And she's just a very sweet person to listen to. And again, like I said, her Vlogmas videos, if you haven't watched them, I would say go watch them. They're really cute, and they were fairly short. They weren't super long videos. But go back and watch them just for something fun to do. Because again, a lot of snippets of the city in there too. The city at Christmas was kind of neat. And just as sort of a side note, even though these aren't new to me because I know I was watching them prior to 2016, but three podcasts that I continue to really enjoy and look forward to every time they come out with new episodes, video-wise, are Katie and her Inside Number 23 podcast, which she also did Vlogmas, which was a lot of fun. Kristen and Yarngasm from Wool and Vine Yarns, her Yarngasm podcast I love, and I always look forward to that. And she also did Vlogmas, so her Vlogmas videos were fun. And then an audio podcast is Down Cellar Studio with Jen, Boston Jen, which I've listened to that for way longer than just this year, but I still enjoy that when she records. So those are ones that I just, they're the ones I always look for. And then there's all the other ones that I watch as I can and I get them in there. But I think we all have our favorites. We all have our favorite podcasts, the ones that we look for those new episodes when they pop up. So I'm like everybody else. I have my favorites too. Okay, I think that's everything knit-wise. So let's move into 10%, and I'm going to continue the favorite other things theme, the favorite theme with other things that are non-knitting related. So I thought I would talk a little bit about my favorite books from this year. I did not really read physical books this year that I can think of. I'm trying to think if I did actually finish any actual physical books, but I listened to at least 16 audiobooks this year, maybe a few more. I can't remember because some I purchased prior to this year, but I don't remember when I listened to them. But I thought I would tell you about a few that I know I listened to this year and really enjoyed. Nonfiction, and the majority of what I listened to this year was nonfiction, actually, which is odd. Well, it's not odd. I love nonfiction, but I had been on a fiction kick there for a while. Anyway, nonfiction-wise, a book called Etymologicon by Mark Forsyth, which I know I've told you all about these as I was listening to them, but that was definitely a favorite. It was a book about the origin of words and the way he did it, just like one went into the next, and I just loved that format. And it was very entertaining. The reader was very entertaining to listen to. He did a great job. So I could highly recommend that as an audiobook. I don't know what it would be like to actually physically read it, but the audiobook was definitely enjoyable. Is Everyone Hanging Out Without Me by Mindy Kaling. That was kind of a surprise to me that I enjoyed that as much as I did, because I just, I like memoir books, autobiography kind of books, and I figured, oh, that would be fine, kind of like a fun, potato chippy, quick listen. And it was a fairly quick listen, but it was really good. And that is a great book, I think, to recommend to like young adult women. Maybe men too, but definitely like for my daughter, I would definitely get her that book. It was just a really nicely told story of Mindy's earlier life and her, launching again into adulthood and her acting career and all of that. And she just seemed like a very nice person, like somebody that I would want to hang out with. So I enjoyed that. I also listened to her follow-up book. Excuse me. Why Not Me? And that was also good. Along the nonfiction again, memoir. And I know I listened to this last year, but I also listened to it this year because I'm sorry, I'm gonna cough again. I'm trying not to. I've listened to this book at least 2 dozen times, and I'm not kidding. That's not an exaggeration. It's Furiously Happy by Jenny Lawson. Wonderful book, wonderful book, wonderful book. She has done amazing things to destigmatize mental illness while also making it kind of funny. Like having a humorous memoir about mental illness, seems very juxtaposed, but she has done it, and I have loved that book. And even though I don't share a lot of her issues, I can associate with enough of them that that book just has been a wonderful thing for me. I've not listened to it in a while now because I had listened to it so much. I finally needed to move on, but I can see myself totally listening to that book again in the future. Excellent book. And lastly is the one I'm listening to now. I'm still in the middle of it, is Born to Run by Bruce Springsteen. Again, if you're a Bruce Springsteen fan or you know somebody, get the audiobook. He reads it. It's been fabulous. I love it. As far as fiction, which again, I didn't read a whole lot of fiction or listen to a whole lot of fiction this year, but The Paris Wife by Paula MacLean, which I just finished recently, that was very good. I didn't like how it ended, but since it was historically based, it had to end basically how her life went, and so it was okay. But it was a good book, and she did it. I really liked the writing in it. The Girl on the Train, which I forgot to write down the author of that. Actually, I wrote down a different author, but that was a different book. I can't remember if I listened to The Girl on the Train this year or last year, but it was good. It was like one of those unexpected ending kind of mystery. It was different, suspenseful, and I really enjoyed that. I've listened to a few books by Susanna Kearsley. The Firebird, I'm pretty sure, is one I listened to this year. And that sort of went along with the first book that I read, The Winter Sea. They were both very good, and they were sort of time travel novels and set in Scotland and just lovely. I enjoyed those a lot. And then there's also Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children by Ransom Riggs. I did enjoy that book. Towards the end, I was kind of like, okay, really? I wasn't buying the plot line quite as much, although considering the whole plot and the storyline, like you have to suspend disbelief anyway. But I did enjoy it. So I did not see the movie, don't know how it compares, but the book was good. I've not read any of the sequels to it, the subsequent books. If you have and you have an opinion on them, let me know in the comments because I'm not sure whether I want to read any of the next ones or not. Okay, let's go on to favorite concerts and shows. This was a huge concert show year for me. 18. I went through my calendar and I counted. Bill and I went to 18 different concerts or shows of some sort this year, which is kind of crazy because I go for years without going to anything and then suddenly, wham, get all these shows under my belt. But I would say my favorites, a couple of them would be from the folk music series that we go to every year. And Ronnie Arbo and Daisy Mayhem was one that I really enjoyed. I loved their music at the concert, and I've continued to listen to it because we bought some of their CDs. I've listened to it a lot since then. So that was really, really good. Another one that we saw through that series was De Tom Sont Ton, which they're from Quebec, and they do that traditional Quebecois, I know I'm pronouncing that really wrong, traditional music that's kind of got almost like a Cajun-y and Irish feel to it. It's just so neat. We saw them twice this year, actually. As far as larger shows and concerts, hands down, the absolute best one I saw concert-wise was Weird Al Yankovic. I know that might sound really weird, but he put on a phenomenal show, and I would have been happy if it would have continued all night long. It was fabulous. He is a genius. He is. He's musically just incredible. Everything was incredible about that show. Loved it. As far as non-actual concerts, we did go see Phantom of the Opera this year, which I know I should be more enthusiastic about that. It was okay. I thought the whole thing was kind of creepy, but whatever, the storyline. The one that we saw, and we just saw it last night, so you haven't heard about it, was a show that we were gifted the tickets by Bill's sister. She bought them for us for our Christmas gift. And it was Cirque Dreams Holidays. So the Cirque franchise, it's not like Cirque du Soleil. Well, it's, I guess maybe similar, I don't know. It's basically like a mashup of circus performing and ballet and singing and just all kinds of aerial stuff, and it was amazing. I can't even begin to explain. And I also could not tell you the plot. There was sort of like an overlying theme, like Father Time wakes up and finds the Christmas ornaments are no longer asleep. That was the general theme. I couldn't really begin to tell you how that related to a lot of the things going on, but the aerial, like the people in those hoops and with the long silk things, and then they're up in the air and they're spinning around. This one woman was suspending herself from this hoop with nothing but the back of her head. Like the hoop was like right here and she's leaning on it, and that's the only thing holding her up while she's spinning around in the air. I'm like watching this, like she's gonna fall and kill herself. But there was just that, there was contortionists doing this, just very elaborate, and the costuming was beautiful. Oh my gosh, so sparkly and beautiful. The singers, their voices were fabulous. Just, there was juggler, there were a guy who did all kinds of crazy balancing stuff where you just thought for sure he was going to plunge to his death any moment. Just I can't even tell. It was just an amazing show. We really, really enjoyed it. We went in having no clue what it was about, not knowing what we were going to see. And then we were just like, wow. The whole time, we're like, wow, it was amazing. So we had a lot of fun at that. So, favorite destination. We traveled 10 times this year. Again, it's either feast or famine for me when it comes to travel. I would say there are three places that. I mean, some of it was work-related travel as well, I have to say, but that's fun too. The three places that I will say are my favorites for this year. Number one was Antigua, because number one, I had never been there before. It was beautiful. We had a lovely time, and Bill asked me to marry him while we were there, so that definitely makes it a favorite location. Florida would have to be a favorite location because my mom lives there, and we got married there. This year, it also ties for maybe a least favorite destination only because I had to go down for my stepfather's funeral. And so that was not a happy thing. But, overall, it's still a nice destination. And lastly, was Canada, our trip to Killarney Provincial Park, our canoe trip. It was fabulous. And I just enjoyed it so, so much. Just new experiences and, yeah, it was great. So it was a good travel year for us. And lastly, my favorite accomplishment of this year. That's kind of a murky thing because you're always accomplishing things, and sometimes it feels like just surviving life in general, especially with all of the changes and transitions going on in my life. Sometimes that feels like a major accomplishment. But specifically, I would have to say learning how to ride a motorcycle and getting my motorcycle license this year, that was like my biggest accomplishment for the year. Because it was something that I knew absolutely nothing about going into it. And so I was learning from the ground up on that. And I'm really proud of myself for how well I did and what I've been able to achieve with that. So it was a good year. All in all, honestly, 2016 was a very good year. Aside again from losing my stepfather, and just, some minor stuff here and there. Now, politically in the world, we won't go there. Not a great year, from my perspective, but that's besides the point. Personally, for me, I feel like this was a wonderful year, and I have so much to be thankful for, and I am thankful for it. And again, most thankful. See, my marriage, I don't consider getting married an accomplishment. That was a very happy thing. And if I had to name like my favorite happy thing of the year, definitely getting married was it. But that seems like a bigger, more overall thing because it's not just about the day you get married. It's, you know, excuse me, it's the marriage itself, which is a long-term project. Anyway, like I said, I will talk about goals and aspirations for next year, but I'll talk about those the next time I record because this is already getting a little bit long and I don't want to bore you with that too. Plus, I need to give it a little bit more thought. I just haven't had a lot of time to think about it this week with everything being so crazy. Anyway, let's go into shop news. Again, not a whole lot, but I will tell you that today is the last day to post anything, any finished objects you have for the Fiber Nymph Dyeworks finished object fourth quarter thread. So, you know, anything that you knit or spun out of Fiber Nymph Dyeworks yarn or fiber, in the last 3 months, post it to that before the end of today, your time. I will close that thread tomorrow. Excuse me, and then I will open the first quarter thread for 2017, and I will announce the winner for that for the fourth quarter next time I record. And that's a $25 gift certificate to the shop, so you can look forward to that next time. I just want to let you know also that my year-end sale is still going on through tomorrow. So midnight Eastern tomorrow, that's when that'll end. The coupon code is year end 16, and that takes 16% off your entire order, anything in stock or special order items that are in the shop. You can use that. What else? Yeah, there's not a lot left in the shop. Stock is very down right now, but that was kind of the point. I wanted to clean out all the old inventory so that I could start putting new stuff up come the beginning of the year. So, and related to that, there will be a shop update on Friday, January 6th. So the first Friday in January, at least I think that's the 6th. Is that the 6th? Let me just double check. Yes, the 6th at 6 p.m. Eastern. I was hoping it would be a fairly sizable update. However, with the activities going on here in the house this week, curtailing my dyeing ability because I could dye, but I couldn't dry stuff in the basement because it's where my drying area is. I couldn't put wet yarn out in the basement with all of this dust in the air. It would have not ended well for anybody. So I have not been able to get as much done as I would have liked, but there will be an update. There will be some new colorways, new items. So be looking for that. I've been doing my best to get as many special orders and custom orders that have been placed out before the end of the year. I have a lot of them done. There's a few that are finished, but they're not reskeined, so you can look forward to those going out in the next few days. And then I will be starting to work on pre-order the Mountain House winter pre-orders. I'll be working on this coming week as well. So anyway, I think that's everything. And again, next week when I talk about, you know, looking forward to 2017, I have some shop and business stuff that I'm looking forward to 2017, and I'll talk a little bit more about that then as well. It's going to be a good year. I hope it's going to be a good year for all of us. That's my biggest hope. But anyway, I'm going to end now and just again say Happy New Year. Please be safe, have fun. I hope you have friends or family nearby that you can celebrate with, or I hope you have a lovely quiet evening by yourself if that's your thing, even if you go to bed by 8 o'clock. Because I don't always stay up till midnight. I probably will tonight because my kids are here, but I don't always. But it's nice. No, whatever you do, just enjoy it and may 2017 be wonderful for all of us. Take care.